Well, last week we began our series called Finding Your Way in the Religious Maze. And the first key question to find your way is, does God exist? Last time I spoke with two people who said, no, there's nothing more beyond the physical world. But today, we hear from someone who says, yes, but that doesn't mean that we're on the same spiritual continent or even in the same hemisphere yet, so to speak. I mean, this is where the maze starts to get complicated because people have radically different ideas about what God is like. And your theological views then shape how you relate to other ideas and other religions. I mean, do all roads lead to God? Should we show tolerance or even acceptance of other views? These are the questions that arise through my conversation with a devout Hindu. Now, to step back for a moment, I grew up in a suburb called La Crescenta, about 20 miles north of downtown Los Angeles. And by my recollection, it was a fairly diverse area with people of various religions and nationalities and ethnicities. But you know, I didn't think much about that at the time. I mean, religion was never even discussed in my family. We never went to church. So as a child, my attention was just really focused on school and play. And one of the toys I remember loving was an inflatable punching bag shaped like a clown. I mean, after being bullied at school, you could come home and just unleash your frustration on it. It had a sandbag in the base, you know, so it, that would keep it upright. And it had a bright red nose that would squeak when you hit it. So you could easily knock it over. You could send it flying across the room and it'd never fight back. And so it made me feel, you know, invincible. It made me feel superhuman as I pummeled it. But the fun never lasted long because it was just cheap. You know, it was nothing more than vinyl puffed up with air that I blew into it myself. I mean, after a few days of abuse, it almost inevitably popped and then left me feeling mortal again until I could get back to the discount store to get another one. But I raise that to say, when we talk about opposing views in religion or even in politics or other areas, there's this temptation to treat them like one of those punching bags. Right? We puff up a cheap, thin, plastic version of the view that we can knock around easily. I mean, in the study of logic, that approach is called a straw man fallacy. Right? We distort the position by exaggerating its weaknesses, or we cherry-pick damning statements and pull them out of context, or maybe we use the idea of a slippery slope to accuse the other side of things that they never actually do or say. Or we also engage in what's called an ad hominem attack, an attack against the person, pointing out hypocritical behavior in certain individuals and applying it to the group as a whole. So what's really accomplished when you approach an argument that way? Well, it makes you feel superior and powerful in the moment, treating the other side like mindless idiots. Plus, I mean, a dramatic fight always draws a crowd. The people who already agree with you love it. But here's the thing. Inaccurate, exaggerated portrayals of an opposing view are nothing more than a lie. And so rather than strengthening your position, they actually undermine it because it suggests that you don't think your view is strong enough to withstand an honest comparison. Now, I believe that a biblically sound Christian worldview doesn't need and shouldn't use those kinds of shoddy tactics. I mean, in fact, I think when someone does that in the name of Christianity, they're actually violating biblical teaching. So before we go further today, let me just share a few passages about speaking the truth. I mean, to start off, fundamental basis that we see in the Old Testament, the ninth of the Ten Commandments says, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. It's Exodus 20, verse 16. And then we turn to the Proverbs. Proverbs 12, verses 17 through 19. Whoever speaks the truth gives honest evidence, but a false witness utters deceit. And catch this, there's one whose rash words are like sword thrusts, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Truthful lips endure forever, but a lying tongue is but for a moment. So even when we disagree with someone, we need to show respect for them because they're created in the image of God. In the New Testament letter, James talks about how we use our tongues. In James 3, verses 9 through 10, he says, "With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not be so." And then just one more passage, the Apostle Paul says that spiritually mature Christians must even go beyond just respect. In verse 15 of chapter 4 in Ephesians, he writes, "Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ." So is it possible to respectfully disagree? Can you lovingly say, "I'm sorry, but I think you're wrong"? I believe so. And those are the convictions that guide this comparison of religious viewpoints that we're doing in this series. But we move now to a part in the maze that really challenges that way of thinking. Today, we'll hear from Dr. Pradip Sagdeo. He's a retired aerospace engineer who's a devout Hindu. And he's one of the founding leaders of the Indo-American Cultural Center and Temple here in Portage. Now, Hinduism is considered the world's third largest religion after Christianity and Islam. In 2015, the Pew Research Center estimated that there are 1.1 billion Hindus. That's 15% of the world's population. Most of them live in India and Nepal, making up 80% of the population in those countries. But they also account for significant percentages of the population in countries like Mauritius, Fiji, Guyana, Bhutan, Suriname, Trinidad, Qatar, Sri Lanka, and Kuwait. In the United States, there are roughly 2.3 million Hindus. But I'll show later that I think the religion's influence extends much farther. Now, because of concerns over the coronavirus, Dr. Sagdeo preferred to interact through a Zoom meeting. As you might expect of someone who spent his career as an engineer, he came very well prepared with PowerPoint slides. So in some of the video clips, you'll just see his slide and not his face real clearly. But he presented this very detailed introduction to Hinduism that lasted over 90 minutes. In fact, he answered most of my questions before I had a chance to ask them. So if you're interested, you can watch the entire interview. I created a Finding Your Way in the Religious Maze YouTube channel, and you'll find it there, and also the interviews that we heard from last week. But before we get into his presentation, here's a little bit of his personal story.
I come from a family with a very strong religious background and upbringing.
Okay.
My grandfather, my mother's father, had a temple, a Shiva temple. In that particular temple, it's called Dakshinamurti, which is another name of Shiva.
Okay.
In the family, owned by the family on the family property. And it is a very major temple in my hometown of Nagpur in India. And throughout the year, there are various religious functions that happen there. And we grew up in that environment. My grandfather and his younger brother taught us to recite and memorize the Sanskrit scriptures, including the Bhagavad Gita and other hymns of our rituals.
Okay.
So that's the background I come from.
So after talking with Dr. Sagdeo, I would summarize the Hindu worldview with three phrases: many gods, many lives, many ways. When you visit the website for the Indo-American Cultural Center and Temple, you're greeted by a picture of several colorful statues on a platform against a sky blue backdrop. Some of them have a human form, but others do not. One has the head of an elephant. And these are the different deities worshipped at the various times at the temple. And now in India, I think you'll typically find temples devoted exclusively to one deity. There's lots of temples, lots of different deities. But since there's only one temple here in our area, it accommodates a variety of worship preferences. So how is it then that one religion can have such variety? Well, Dr. Sagdeo explains.
By virtue of the fact that each one of us is unique, we have multiple gods, goddesses, their children as gods, their devotees as gods, and they all mimic the human condition so that we can relate to it on a human level. And therefore, we consider them as a part of our society, but somebody with something more superior, more profound than us, and therefore we worship them. They all represent the same ultimate reality for us.
So I don't know if you could hear that last part, but he said they all represent the same ultimate reality for us. So if you ask Hindus, does God exist? They will say yes. They acknowledge the existence of many gods, but those gods are just expressions of what Dr. Sagdeo calls the ultimate reality. And so it can be a bit confusing because at times he talks about there only being one God. But what he means by that is this impersonal force, this ultimate truth expressed in different forms. So here's how he talks about that and links it to the different deities.
The truth is one based on my inclination. I call it Vishnu, I call it Shiva, I call it Brahma, I call it Saraswati, I call it Lakshmi, I call it Ram, I call it Krishna, or whatever other name, Ganesh, and other names I may have for them. And I worship that reality, that ultimate reality in that form. Maybe I call him Ganesh, who has a face of an elephant. Maybe I call him Hanuman, who has a face of a monkey. And maybe I call him Vishnu, who has four arms and has four different kinds of items in his hand.
So how did Hindus arrive at this understanding? Well, some trace the movement's origins back to 1500 BC, which is around the same time that the events of the Exodus were unfolding in Egypt in Old Testament history. But Dr. Sagdeo claims that some Sanskrit scriptures date back to 10,000 BC, and that one of their primary books, the Rig Veda, was completed around 3400 BC. I think some people would disagree, but just like their number of deities, Hindus accept several books as religious literature. Dr. Sagdeo explains it this way.
Hindu religion is not based on one book, sayings of one prophet, or one single god, because Hindu rishis, the seers, realize that each one of us is a very unique person. Each one of us has his own likes and dislikes, and therefore one size fits all, or one god or one prophet fits all, cannot be a proper religion.
So again, that last statement, if you didn't catch it, one size fits all, or one god or one prophet fits all, cannot be a proper religion, was what he said. So many gods. But that then leads to the second phrase to sum up Hinduism, many lives. They call Hinduism the eternal religion. And part of that is they have a very different conception of time. They believe that the universe has always existed and that it goes through endless cycles of creation, preservation, and dissolution. They also believe that individuals go through those cycles as well. They believe in reincarnation. But reincarnation doesn't always mean that a person comes back in human form. Here's what Dr. Sagdeo said.
By virtue of the fact that Hindus consider that we are human, we are beings that will go through the cycle of life and death multiple times and not necessarily as a human being, every single time, all life is sacred for Hindus. No matter whether it's a cow or a horse or a dog or a cat or an elephant.
So what then determines your experience in this life or the next? Well, Hindus believe in the law of karma. And here's how Dr. Sagdeo describes that.
I am doing some work through this body. The results of this work are what is called karma. And those karmas are like two different bank accounts that I have for myself. One is a account of good karma or good actions, and the other one is of bad karma or bad actions. I enjoy the fruits of my good karma and I suffer the consequences of my bad karma. These two accounts do not negate each other by coming together. Each one of them has to be paid for, so to speak, by its own consequences. Good consequences of good karma and bad consequences of bad karma. They may happen right in this life, or may happen in the next life, or 10 or 50 or 100 lives from now on.
So the goal of Hinduism then is to transcend or to escape that cycle. In fact, at one point, Dr. Sagdeo used the word salvation. So toward the end of our conversation, I asked him to explain what he meant by that. Here's what he said.
Salvation is the reaching of the ultimate reality and getting out of this cycle of birth, life and death.
Okay.
The human purpose of the human life is to perform action that will not leave any fruit of that action to be enjoyed or to suffer from. When you therefore perform actions that will not attach any consequence to you, you ultimately end up with nothing to enjoy and nothing to suffer from. When you reach that state, that is when you become one with the universal spirit and your soul is freed from the cycle of life and death, and you reach salvation, which is moksha in our Hindu religion.
Okay.
So again, salvation being, in their mind, becoming one with the universe and space. So many gods, many lives, and then that leads them to say that there are many ways to that salvation. They liken it, or he likened it in our conversation, to climbing a mountain. The idea being that there are many paths to the summit, that it's a personal journey. He even said that you really have to figure it out on your own, that a seer or a prophet from the past could only take you so far. But the idea in Hinduism is that you have the ability to do that because you're really already connected to that ultimate reality. Here's how Dr. Sagdeo explained it.
Hindus think that every soul is potentially divine. Unlike some other people who think that we are born sinners and we need salvation through some prophet, some god, some deity, some book. Hindus basically think that we are all potentially divine. Our goal in this life and whatever lives that we may live hereafter is to manifest that divinity within us by controlling our nature externally and internally through means of work or worship or psychological control or philosophy, and these are the various different names of the yogas.
So one of the most offensive things you can do from a Hindu perspective is to say that a person's on the wrong path. Now, toward the end of my conversation with Dr. Sagdeo, it's one final clip I want to share with you. I asked him about that whole idea, about sort of, can there be a right and wrong way? And here's how he responded.
we should have mutual respect. Mm-hmm. It's not that we should tolerate each other. We should actually have mutual respect. So if you want to do your worship on a Sunday in a church, by all means, do it. Go there. Worship your God your way to the extent you want to do it, and enjoy the spirituality that you perceive that way. But if I want to worship Hanuman on a Saturday or a Tuesday, do not tell me that I'm doing the wrong thing.
Catch that last part. Do not tell me that I'm doing the wrong thing. So I think Hindu ideas have had a significant influence in the Western world over the past century, really. I mean, the most obvious example, looking back 40 or 50 years or so, is this kind of New Age spirituality that you see with some people, where what they'll do is they'll adopt certain beliefs from Hinduism, like reincarnation or like this idea of personal divinity. And they'll latch onto those ideas and then kind of add to it their own collection of things. But then we also, of course, see its influence in pop culture, right? I mean, isn't it the same sort of ideas that you hear even in stories like Star Wars, with its idea of the Force, and in practices like yoga and meditation? And yet, I think its greatest influence is just this simple idea that it's wrong to say that anyone else's spiritual beliefs could be wrong. I mean, do all paths lead to God? Does it matter where you stand in this maze? Well, by way of contrast, then, let me share a Christian perspective. I think Christianity asserts three essential truths that contradict the Hindu worldview at each point that I've identified. Now, I'm not trying to be contentious or to be disrespectful, but to be a Christian, by definition, is to say that there's only one God, that there's only one life, and that there's only one way. And so when I say these are essential truths, I mean that if you abandon any of these ideas, you've stepped beyond the bounds of biblical Christianity. So let's unpack these a little bit. The whole idea of there being only one God. I mean, he's not, in biblical teaching, God is not an impersonal force that's just out there in everything through the universe. He has characteristics of personhood, right? Because we know that in part because we're made in his image. And as the creator, he is set apart from his creation, including us. Isaiah and Jeremiah use the picture of showing him as the potter and we are the clay. There's a difference, right? There's a separation. Now, of course, in the ancient world, Old Testament times and New Testament times, polytheism was common. Each nation had their own deities, and some even worshipped a pantheon of gods. And as in Hinduism, those deities were often associated with various animals or forces in nature. But the Creator God of the Bible asserted his exclusive authority and his separation from creation in the first two of the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20, verses 3 and 4 tell us that he said, "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth." So God doesn't leave it up to people to choose their own approach to worship. I mean, some might prefer to have some kind of idol to focus their attention, but he prohibits it, right? Because it maligns his transcendent character. It undermines his authority. And part of the problem is that the use of idols, in a way, puts the worshiper in control. It suggests that through the right rituals that the worshiper can enlist the deity in helping them fulfill their personal agenda for health, for prosperity, or even enlightenment. But the worship of the true God, catch this, is a matter of humbly surrendering to him, not because of anything we get from him, but simply because he's worthy of our devotion. So in Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4 through 5, Moses proclaimed, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Now, you might wonder at this point how the Christian idea of the Trinity fits into this Old Testament monotheism. And I'll come back to that topic next time as I share excerpts from my interview with a Jewish rabbi. But for now, let me just say that Christianity unequivocally asserts that God is one. And we find that stated very clearly in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 4 through 6. The Christians in Corinth were wrestling with life in a polytheistic culture. And so Paul told them, "Therefore, as to the eating of foods offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one." And then he says, "For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God the Father, from whom are all things, and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things, and through whom we exist." So there's only one God. And that leads next to the idea that there is only one life. Rather than viewing history as cyclical, as they do in Hinduism, the Bible presents the idea of history as linear. God's eternal with no beginning and end, but he creates the universe within time. He charts its course as if he's drawing a straight line. In fact, he even talks about his control of time through the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 46, 9 through 10 says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there's none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all my purpose." So he's the Lord of time. And that linear path then applies to us as humans. I mean, each person is a unique soul created by God at the moment of conception. So Hebrews 9:27 adds to that, on the other side, "It's appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment." So from a biblical point of view, people will not be reincarnated as a different person or as an animal. After death, they'll be resurrected to face God's judgment that will determine their eternal destiny. And that's really where our problem lies, right? The sinful deeds that we commit in this life can't be worked out or repaired or fixed through our own efforts, because they're not violations of just some abstract principle out in the universe, but they're personal offenses against a holy God, and his justice must be served. So what hope is there for people to enter into eternal life? So we say that there's one God, that there's one life, and there's only one way. That God provided a way, a bridge to carry us through judgment into eternal life. When one of Jesus' disciples asked him about the path to eternity in God's presence, John 14:6 tells us, Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." In his death, Jesus paid the price to satisfy God's justice for all who believe in him. And the apostles understood this. Acts 4:12 tells us that Peter spoke of Jesus and declared, "There is salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Now, some people argue that it's arrogant or harsh, narrow-minded to assert that there's only one way. But follow my logic here. If there's only one true God, and he's provided only one way, then who am I to question it? I mean, what right do I have to sit in judgment over him? I mean, would it not be the height of arrogance for me to insist that he conform to my expectations of the way things should be, of what I think is right and wrong? wouldn't it be deeply offensive to him when he's provided a way of salvation for me to say that I don't need that, that I can work it out on my own? And if I know a fellow human being who's on some other path, though I can be respectful, how can I approve of that person's spiritual direction? I mean, wouldn't that be cold-hearted? Shouldn't love for God and for that person compel me to say something? It's interesting, in talking to different people, you know, in all of these interviews, I'm asking people what they believe about Jesus. And it's not uncommon to hear someone quote or at least refer to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and to the Beatitudes and to say that he's a good teacher. But you know, when you get to the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14 tell us that he said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few." So where do you stand at this juncture in the maze? If you believe, as we talked about last week, that life is more than physical matter, that there is something more, are you willing to accept then the existence of one holy creator God? If you'd like to learn more about the Christian view of God compared to other religions, you could read Acts chapter 17, verses 22 through 34. There, Paul interacts with the philosophers in Athens. And then if you do believe in the God of the Bible, do you fall into that temptation of passing your own judgment about what's right and wrong? Or are you humbly submitting your thoughts about life and morality and salvation to his word? And if you believe that Jesus is the way, would you be willing to start a conversation with someone to ask them what they think and to speak the truth in love? May God lead us forward in truth and in representing him today.